Jesus is waiting there with open arms.
Aren't you thankful for how he loves? Amen. Just remain standing this morning. Love singing the hymns of Christmas. They tell the story. Would you sing it with me? Let's sing it.
The first
those songs this morning. Praise the Lord. You can be seated. They tell the story of Christmas, and it also gives us an opportunity to sing the lyrics, some of them that even the angels sang when we sing these Christmas songs. So Christmas in the Ville is next weekend, so Saturday night and Sunday night at 6, the choir and orchestra, children's choirs, everybody's been preparing for some great music, and we want you to bring your friends and your family and come enjoy a night of Christmas worship, but also the message of the gospel. And so we're going to give you a little taste this morning, the next couple of Sunday mornings, of the music from Christmas in the Ville. This is one of those songs, you're familiar with it, it tells the story of Christmas, and the chorus is one that you can really sing. It's called Gloria.
Thank you. Oh, how wonderful. That'll put you in the Christmas spirit, will it not? Our team did a wonderful job decorating our church this week, and as we're singing these carols and hymns of the season, it's just uplifting our hearts. You'll want to invite some people to come with you this coming Saturday and Sunday. We're looking forward to just having a full house. There are very few places you can go that you'll experience the joy of the Christmas season like you'll be able to experience on Saturday evening and Sunday evening in Christmas in the Ville. Our choir and orchestra have been working for months, but it's not only we're going to enjoy the songs of the season, but also going to hear the gospel proclaimed in a very simple, very clear way. Invite others to come with you. It's a way to share Jesus Christ with others, and so we're looking forward, and you pray that God will work this week in the hearts of many this coming weekend. I want to say a word of welcome to those of you that are guests today. We welcome you to First Baptist Hendersonville. It's our prayer. We prayed for you early this morning that you would experience the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ and that he would speak to your heart today. Just a moment, we're going to continue with our musical worship. Let's worship through prayer now. So let's bow together. And as I pray, you have an opportunity just to spend a few moments personally with the Lord as well. Our Father, today, we rejoice and we thank you that we can celebrate that God is with us, Emmanuel. Father, we thank you the gift that you have given in your Son, Jesus Christ, born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died as a sacrifice for us, rose again, lives today so that we can have eternal life. Our Father, may this season be a season of our renewal, of our commitment to you, will deepen our love for you, and will put an excitement in our hearts such that we cannot help but tell others about you, Jesus Christ. We thank you today that we have your word, and we thank you for a pastor that is anointed. We thank you that he is going to boldly proclaim your truth today. Lord, may that truth just go deep into each of our hearts, our lives, our minds, and transform us to become more like Jesus Christ. I pray for those that do not know Jesus, those that are in this room, those that are watching by the way of live stream today. Lord, speak clearly to them, and I pray today would be the day of salvation. We give ourselves to you as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to you. This truly is our act of worship. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Treasure rich and rare, marvelous and holy.
Remain standing. This little chorus we've been singing the last few months, it's appropriate right here. Let's just sing to the Lord.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you.
Praise the Lord. You can be seated. These songs that we sing tell the story, and I love hearing all of those great lyrics, and we're going to continue to sing these familiar, wonderful songs during the month of December. Aren't you thankful for the orchestra? Don't they do a fabulous? I'm just so thankful for them. They do such a great, great job. And some of y'all could be in the choir this morning. You've got your red and your green on. Y'all could join us up. No, you don't want to? Okay. We'll talk about that in January, all right? But some of these songs are fun, and we're going to do one right now that just tells us what we're supposed to do now that we've heard the message. What are we supposed to do? Scripture says we're supposed to go and tell. So this one is kind of fun, so I'm preparing you. Maybe I'm preparing myself for what's about to happen. But Jenny is going to, she's going to preach this one. She's not just going to sing it, but it's just simply called Go Tell It on the Mountain. Here we go.
Yeah. Amen. Jenny, come here. Jenny, come here. Yes. Teach me how to do that. Is that it? I may throw that one in during the sermon. Welcome to the First Baptist Church of Hendersonville. Yeah, in the early service, Jason said, I just want to prepare you for this. And I'm thinking to myself, Jason, we all know Jenny. There's only one person that doesn't know what's about to happen, and that's him. We all know what's going to happen. Thank you, Jenny. Rich, Lydia, thank you for those songs, choir and orchestra. Hey, don't miss next Saturday and Sunday. Going to be a great event. Invite somebody to come with you. It's the best Christmas event in Hendersonville, and you need to invite somebody to come and be with you. Well, take your Bible and find Luke chapter 6. While you're finding that, let me tell you, ladies, I've had something happen in the first service that makes me identify with all of you. My suspender snapped in the first service. Now, if you've ever had your bra strap snap, I know what that feels like. You know nothing's going to happen, but it still makes you uncomfortable, right? You know? So I got mine fixed up and ready to go. Well, today we're going to stay in Luke chapter 6 in our regular study. And then next Sunday, which will be the 11th and the 18th, and of course Christmas Day, we'll be looking at some passages that relate to Christmas. You would expect that. But today we're going to stay with the passage that we're studying in Luke 6. And when we get to January 1, of course, we'll jump back to where we leave off today. Now, this passage sounds very similar to the Sermon on the Mount. You know that that is found in Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. And in Matthew 5, there's a section of it that we call the Beatitudes. And this sounds very similar to it, but it's not the same. There's some nuances here that are different. The place is different. You know, it's not unusual when musicians go somewhere to sing the same song that they've sung 1,000 times. Mark Lowry has sung Mary, Did You Know? Probably 10,000 times. He's made a career on that song. But you would be disappointed if you went to hear him sing and he didn't sing that song. You know, you go hear Diamond Rio. There's some songs we want to hear you guys sing. You know, it's what we expect. So it wasn't unusual for Jesus when he would go speak somewhere that he would say oftentimes the same thing, but it's a new group of people. It's a different place. The message was always the same. And so this is really the same thing that Jesus said in the Matthew 5 passage, but there are enough differences that we know that it's not just Luke's account of the Sermon on the Mount. This is different. He's speaking to a different group of people. Let's pick it up in verse 12, and we'll read down through verse 26. It says, during those days he went out to the mountain to pray and spent all night in prayer to God. When daylight came, he summoned his disciples and he chose 12 of them. He also named them apostles, Simon, who he also named Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. After coming down with them, he stood on a level place with a large crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon. They came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those tormented by unclean spirits were made well. The whole crowd was trying to touch him because power was coming from him and healing them all. Then looking up at his disciples, he said, blessed are you who are poor because the kingdom of God is yours. Blessed are you who are hungry now because you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now because you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, insult you, and slander your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. Take note, your reward is great in heaven, because this is the way their ancestors used to treat the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, because you have received your comfort. Woe to you who are full now, because you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, because you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, because this is the way their ancestors used to treat the false prophets. Now, there are a lot of ways to take any passage of Scripture and kind of divide it up and look at it and exegete it. There are a lot of ways to do that and be true to the biblical passage, the Scripture. What I'm going to do today is take four words, and I hope with four words I'll give you some handles that will help you grasp this passage and understand what Jesus is saying to us. So four words, here they are. Here's the first one. It's in verse 12, and it's the word prayer. Now notice what he says there. During those days, he went out to the mountain to pray, and he spent all night in prayer to God. It's always amazed me that Jesus, who was God incarnate, Jesus, who was God on earth, Jesus, who is God, who became a man, that Jesus felt the need to spend time in prayer. I mean, he is God. And yet what he was doing there was important because of his humanity. Jesus was all God, but he was at the same time all man. And because of his humanity, he needed to spend time with the Heavenly Father. Now, my suggestion to you is very simple. If Jesus needed to spend time with the Father, how much more do we need to spend time with him? And you know, sometimes Jesus spent time with the Father just to spend time with him. He wasn't asking for anything. He didn't need anything. He just spent time with the Father. You know, it's an interesting phenomenon, isn't it? When one of your children comes to you and they just want to spend time with you, they're not asking for anything. They don't need anything. They don't want anything. They just want to spend time with you. That puts a different twist on things. And there's something wonderful about that, someone just wanting to spend time with you. But anytime Jesus had a significant decision to make, you read Scripture, he always took it to the Father. He always sought the wisdom that came from above. And he's about to pick his disciples, his apostles. He's about to make a very important decision, and so he spent the night before in prayer. There's a lesson for us. Before we make decisions, before we determine directions in life, we should always take those things to the Lord and seek his face. So prayer is the first one. The second one is, I'm using the word picks. Picks. When I was a kid and we would play, our playground was the Church Street Elementary School about a block from my house. There were 12 or 15 of us that lived in my neighborhood. And most afternoons after school and during the summer every day, we would gather there on the playground and we'd just decide who'd be the captains. You'd be a captain, you'd be a captain, and they started picking. You're on my team, you're on my team, you're on my team. We'd just go to each side, whether we were playing football or baseball or basketball, whatever it was, we picked the teams. Well, that's what Jesus is doing in this passage. He's making his picks. Now, there are two words that you need to notice. Sometimes we kind of use these words interchangeably, and they're not interchangeable. They're two different things. Look at what it says there in verse 13. It says, when daylight came, he summoned his disciples. Now, underline the word disciples. He summoned his disciples, and he chose 12 of them. He named them apostles. So underline the word apostles. Two different words, disciples, apostles. Now, what's the difference? Well, disciples, the word disciple means to be a follower, a learner. We're learning from somebody. And every great teacher had disciples. John the Baptist had disciples. The Pharisees had disciples. Aristotle had disciples. Plato had disciples. College professors today have disciples. They don't call them that. But that's what they're the mentor to them. They're learning their ways. They're kind of training them in the way that they think and the way they're going. And so those students are learning from them. So a disciple is someone who's learning from someone else and who's following them. Jesus had hundreds of disciples, thousands of disciples. He uses that word again a little bit further down in verse 17. He says, after coming down with them, he stood at a level place with a large crowd of his disciples. At one point, Jesus is going to send 70 disciples out on a mission. So Jesus had hundreds of disciples. Now, we kind of use the word disciple to talk about the 12 disciples, but that's not the right word. A disciple is any person who's a follower of Jesus. And in chapter 9, Luke chapter 9, this is what Jesus is going to say. If anyone wants to come with me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. So a disciple is anyone who is willing to follow and who is willing to obey. And Jesus had thousands of disciples. He's still calling people to be his disciple. He's still calling people to follow him. Now the second word is the word apostles. It's a different word. The word apostle, literally the word for apostle means to be sent out. And he named these 12 as his apostles. One of them, Judas Iscariot, is going to betray Jesus. This passage calls him a traitor. Following that, because of his guilt, he killed himself. After that occurred, the early church, according to Acts chapter 1, the early church was tasked with replacing Judas. And in Acts chapter 1, they selected a man named Matthias to take the place of Judas to round out the 12. But here Jesus is making his picks. And it's a strange group. I mean, it really is. It's an unusual mix of people. It doesn't really seem to get along. And when we read in Acts about them, Acts says that they were a group of unlearned and ignorant. Boy, they're really building them up, aren't they? Unlearned and ignorant men. That means they didn't have any formal education. They were nobodies. They weren't who's who. They were who's not. And nobody knew who they were. And yet these are the men Jesus called. And even in just looking at the men, there's some differences here that make you wonder how they got along. For example, did you see Simon is called the Zealot? That's a political term. Zealot was a right winger. He hated government. He hated Rome. He didn't want to have anything to do with it. And yet one of the apostles was Matthew. Matthew worked for Rome. Matthew was a tax collector. Now, don't you know they had some interesting conversations around the campfire every night when they got back in from following Jesus? It's a strange group of people, and yet these are the ones Jesus picked. You know, we might look ourselves over and say, well, we're a strange group too, and yet he has picked us. He has asked us, called us to follow him. So there's prayer. They're the picks. Look at the third thing. It's in verse 17, 18, 19. It's the word place. He tells us about the place. He says, after coming down with them, he stood on a level place with a large crowd of his disciples. But not only disciples, some people that were wanting to learn about truth were there. Some people from Jerusalem, all of Judea, Sidon, Tyre. There were a lot of people that had gathered there. Now, this is one of the ways that we know that this is not just a restatement of the Sermon on the Mount. This is a different place. The Sermon on the Mount was in a place up the mountain. And this passage says he came down from the mountain and he was at a level place. So this is a different place. It's a different group. It's the same message, but it's at a different place. Now, we come to the heart of the passage now. First word is prayer. Second word is picks. Third word is place. Here's the fourth two words that I'm using. And just to keep using the P's there in alliteration, I'm calling these positive attitudes. In verse 20 through verse 26, he gives us a list of positive attitudes that will make life better. Now, if your Bible has headings in it, at the beginning of verse 20, it probably says Beatitudes. Now, where does that word come from? It's an interesting word, Beatitudes. I'm calling it positive attitudes. Where does the word beatitude come from? The word that Jesus actually used, the Greek word, is makarios. Makarios. And that word means to be happy or to be blessed, to be fortunate. Jesus used the word makarios, but when Scripture was translated into Latin, now Jesus didn't speak Latin, so he didn't say this word. But when it was translated into Latin, the Latin word for happy or blessed is the word beatus. Beatus. And so that's where Beatitudes comes from. That's why we call them the Beatitudes. But that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said happy or blessed. Now, interestingly, if you ask most Americans, what do you want most out of life? Now, they'll name a lot of things. You know, they'll name stuff, they'll name money, they'll name retirement, they'll name all kinds of things. But one of the things invariably that's very near the top of the list, if not at the top of the list, is I want to be happy. I want to be happy. But then if you pursue that and say, how can you be happy? They don't know how. They don't know how to be happy, but they want to be happy. Now, if you, like most Americans, want to be happy, here you go. Here you go. Jesus gives us a list of things that he says, makarios, happy, blessed, fortunate is the person who has this positive attitude. Now, what he does, and he splits this with verse 23, and I'll end with verse 23, so I'm going to skip that right now, but he puts a positive statement in the top, and then he there's a correlating negative statement that goes with it. Now, you might not have put those together as you're reading this or listening to me read it. You might not have thought of it that way, but let me show you what I'm talking about. Look in verse 20. It says, "Blessed are you who are poor, because the kingdom of God is yours." Now, draw a line down to verse 24, because that's the correlating negative statement. Verse 24 says, "But woe to you who are rich, because you have received your comfort. Blessed are you who are poor, happy are you who are poor, but woe to you who are rich." Now, is Jesus saying that somehow it's sinful or wrong or bad to have money? Well, you know that's not true. I mean, there are enough places in Scripture that we know that's not what he's saying. So by the way, in Matthew's account, in Matthew chapter 5, what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount, it's a little bit different. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." So what's he talking about? Well, he's talking about where you put the value of your life. Where do you find the value for your life? If you think your life has value because of your portfolio, if you think your life has value because of your retirement account or because of the house you own, if you think your life has value because of your net worth, then he says, woe to you, because you've got your blessing out of that. If that's what you're looking for to bring you purpose and meaning in life, well, Lord bless you, you got it. But it's not going to have any more blessing for you. What he's saying here is where you find your value. Now, let me give you an example of what I think explains this. You've seen examples where someone has an object that is auctioned off, and it auctions off for a lot more money than that object is worth. Here's a guitar that doesn't have a tremendous amount of value just as a guitar, but it auctions for a huge amount of money because it belonged to Elvis. Here's a car that doesn't have a great deal of value. It's just kind of a rust bucket, but it auctions off for a lot of money because it belonged to a famous person. Here's a ball, a baseball. It doesn't have a lot of intrinsic value to it, just a few dollars, but it auctions off for tens of thousands of dollars because it was hit for a home run in the seventh game of the World Series. You see, the value is not in the object. The value is in who owned the object. He says our worth, our value is not in our stuff. Our value is in who owns us. Our value is in our relationship to him. So he says, happy is the person who is poor in spirit, but who is pursuing the things that are eternal, that bring true value and true meaning in life. Well, look at the second thing he says, verse 21. Blessed are you who are hungry now, because you will be filled. Draw a line down to verse 25. Woe to you who are full now, because you will be hungry. Now, what's he talking about? Again, obviously, it's not a blessing to be physically hungry, so that's not what he's talking about. And again, Matthew chapter 5 adds a phrase that he doesn't say at this point. Matthew 5 says, blessed are you who hunger and thirst for righteousness. For righteousness. Now, whatever you hunger and thirst for is going to become the driving force of your life. So if you hunger and thirst for fame, you'll do anything to get it. If you hunger and thirst for that promotion and to be the CEO of this Fortune 500 company, you'll climb over anybody you've got to climb over to get it. If the driving force of your life is wealth, you'll do what it takes. But if the driving force of your life is righteousness, if the driving force of your life is to be more like your Creator and to live your life according to His purpose for His glory, then that is what will drive your life. So blessed are you who hunger and thirst, not for money, not for stuff, but for righteousness. And woe to you. Woe to you who are full now. You've got what you were looking for. Whatever that's going to bring you, it's already done it. Well, look at the next two statements that he makes. The end of verse 21. Blessed are you who weep now, because you will laugh. Draw a line down to the end of verse 25. Woe to you who are laughing now, because you will mourn and weep. Well, what's he talking about? again, it's obvious that he's not talking about being an unhappy person. He tells us to be happy. Verse 23 is going to tell us to rejoice, be happy. This whole thing's about being happy, about being blessed, about being fortunate. So what's he talking about? I think he's talking about what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. Paul said, for godly grief, there's that word grief, it's sorrow. That's what he said. Blessed are you who sorrow, who are mournful. Well, what are we sorry? What are we mournful for? Well, Paul says he's talking about a godly grief, a godly sorrow. You ever heard the phrase good grief? Isn't that Charlie Brown's phrase? Good grief, Charlie Brown. You know what good grief is? Good grief is when we sorrow over the sin of our life that has separated us from God. Paul says, because godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation. So blessed are you who have this godly sorrow. Blessed are you who realize that we've sinned against holy God and we've repented of that sin. And as a result of that, he has saved us. But woe to you who are laughing now. Who's laughing? Well, the whole world laughs at sin. You talk to somebody these days about sin, they laugh at you at the very word, at the concept. The world laughs at the idea. He says, blessed are you who have this godly grief, because that grief leads to repentance, and repentance leads to salvation. And woe to you who laugh at the idea of sin, because one day you will weep. Look at the last thing that he says, verse 22. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and slander your name. The correlating passage is verse 26. Woe to you when people speak well of you, because this is the way that their ancestors treated the false prophets. Now, he's talking about rejection and acceptance, and we all like to be accepted. From the time we were kids, we wanted to be accepted. You know, there's a group at school, and you want to be a part of the group. You want to be accepted. You don't want to be the outcast. And he's not telling us to be obnoxious people so that other folks don't want to be around us. That's not the point of this at all. What he's saying is, who are you trying to please? And if we're trying to please this world, We can please this world, and we can get in step with this world, and we can say what the world's saying, and we can be politically correct, and we can go along to get along, and we will be in step with this world, but we will be out of step with the one who created us. And you can't do both. And I hope you know that if you take a stand for the Lord, if you say, thus saith the Lord, if you live your life according to the teachings of God's word, If you speak the name of Jesus in the world we're living in today, you know what somebody's going to say to you? Sit down and shut up. Take that to your church, but we don't want to hear it. That's what this passage is talking about. If we're going to be accepted in this world, then we're going to be out of step with the Lord and his plan. And if we're in step with the Lord and his plan, by nature, we're going to be out of step with this world. So blessed are you who are out of step with the world, because you are walking according to the teachings of the Lord Jesus. Now look at how verse 23 says this, and let's kind of focus on this. I like to end a message with the so what. What is it, you know, what's it saying to us? What does it have to do with us? Well, I didn't have to look for this one. It's right here. He printed it out for us, and he put it kind of by itself so that you can't help but notice it. This is what he says. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. Take note, because your reward is great in heaven. Live with an understanding that this world does not get the final say. Live with an understanding that this world is not going to determine what really matters. Live with an understanding that there is something greater and something more noble than what this world understands, and you are living your life according to that truth. Rejoice in that day, because your reward in heaven is great. Now, suppose I told you that someone is building a master-planned community that is full of mansions. I'm not talking about nice houses. I'm talking about mansions. They are building a planned community of mansions. And if you get into this community, if you find a way into this community, that not only is the mansion provided, but the utilities are provided and the food is provided and the neighbors are incredible. And you will have no problems if you just get into this community. What if I told you that somebody was building a community like that? Well, listen to these words of Jesus in John chapter 14. Let not your heart be troubled. Now, I know we always read this in light of the fact that Jesus was telling them about his death, but let's think of it a different way. Are you troubled by what's going on in the world? Are you troubled by where society is and where we're headed? Have you, like Joy and I, had a conversation about what's it going to be like for our granddaughters when they get just a little bit older? What's the craziness of this world going to be like? Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. Now listen to this. In my Father's house are many mansions. He's building a planned community. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Now listen to this. I'm going to go and prepare a place just for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and get you. I will receive you to myself so that where I am, there you may be also. The disciples said, Lord, where is this place? What are you talking about? We don't know where it is or how to get there. Tell us where it is. We'd love to see this. And Jesus said, I'm the way. You want to have your mansion? In that day, when the blessings will be so great that you can't even comprehend them, you want to experience that. You want to have your mansion that's been prepared for you. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. This world has gone crazy. It's lost its mind. But we don't live by the principles of this world, because there is something greater. And verse 23 says, we live looking for that great day. And one day, it'll be ours. Let's pray together. Father, thank you. Thank you for this promise. This is not a Christmas passage that we've read, but it certainly gives us the Christmas truth. That God became a man. He gave us hope and purpose and meaning, not just in this life. Truthfully, if this is all that there was, it would be enough. But you've given us the promise of life eternal in the place that you prepared just for us. And so, Lord, we thank you. I pray for those today that you're still calling to be your disciples. You're calling men and women to follow you. The question is, will we listen? Will we follow? And will we obey? And I pray that today someone will hear you and someone will say, yes, Lord, wherever you lead, I'll go. There's someone here today that needs to make a commitment. This is their church. You've spoken to their heart. Part of worship is that we respond. There's someone here today that needs to respond. Someone needs to join the church. Someone over here has never been baptized. They need to be baptized. Someone needs to publicly profess before men, Jesus is my Lord. You've spoken. Now help us to respond. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. Bruce and I are waiting. Jason's going to lead us in a song. If the Lord leads you, part of worship is that we respond.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all.
Sing that chorus, Jesus paid.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. And sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Be seated for just a moment. David and Amy, come stand with me, if you will. We normally don't introduce our new members. We usually go to the back and get the information and talk to them about their salvation experience and so forth. But I want to introduce you, and I want you to know David and Amy Morrow. They've come today to be a part of our church. God has led them here over the last several months to be a part of our church. David is a retired minister. He has served Emmanuel Baptist at Lebanon. He was preschool pastor at Long Hollow. But for several months, David served as interim pastor at Crossroads Church at Westmoreland, which is our church partner. And David is really the one that partnered us together with Crossroads. In being their interim pastor, he recognized that they really needed a revitalization process and connected us together and really helped the church to see that that's what they needed for the longevity and for the continuance of that church. And so I wanted you to know them and to make this connection, but also, Pastor, we have a great announcement to make as well concerning Crossroads.
Yeah, we do. It's an amazing thing. We don't have time to tell you the whole story, but as we started looking for the pastor to lead Westmoreland, you know, that community's, it's different than Hendersonville, and it's different than Gallatin. We had some people that are great ministers, and they would say, well, I'd be interested in that, but I want to live in Hendersonville. Well, we felt like we needed somebody that wanted to live in Westmoreland and get to know the people in Westmoreland.